Assalamu alaikum. Good morning. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I want to welcome you all here. This is a very important session, and I think it's something we're hearing right throughout the dialogue here at Atlantic Council. Certainly, we're looking at the energy sector, but the energy sector, again, powering everything around it, and really looking at the diversification of the economies in this region, which is so paramount and so important. And not alone this region, we really have to look a little further. So we're very honored to start this session, and we will have our panel up here in just a few minutes. And we have with us a very distinguished gentleman who comes from the Democratic Republic of Timor-Leste. So we haven't heard too much from him in the past, and we're absolutely thrilled that he's joined us for this session. And when we look at the rise in oil prices and we look at economies that are very, very dependent on oil, we really need to think what else is out there. And as you can see around you, and those of you who are new to Abu Dhabi or those perhaps who haven't been here for a few years, just look around and see the progress that is being made here and how different the city looks just after a few years. In fact, when you come here, the city looks very different after a few months. So there's tremendous progress being made, not just in the city, not in the immediate urban area, but just outside of the city when we look at industry, when we look at manufacturing, and when we look just around other sectors that really need to be developed, and great work and great investment going in there. So we have a wonderful panel that's going to address that. But first, I would really like to welcome to the stage a gentleman who has spent his career, a dedicated career in government service. He served as the president, as the prime minister, and he is currently the Minister of Planning and Strategic Investment. So he comes with a long background in government service, and we're absolutely thrilled he's here, and he really understands the importance of diversification in the economy. So from the Democratic Republic of Timor-Leste, the Minister for Planning and Strategic Investment, Shanana Gusmao. His Excellency, please join us.
Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, wassalamu alaikum. Good morning to everybody. It is a great pleasure to be here in Abu Dhabi to tell the story of our nation and discuss what ways that resource-rich countries can diversify their economies. It is inspiring to have this discussion in Abu Dhabi, a place that has been so transformed, cleverly using the resources blessed upon it, to build a thriving and beautiful city out of the desert. This discussion comes at a critical moment when countries around the world are struggling to meet the challenges of modernity, providing for a young and booming population and creating robust and sustainable economies. This is especially challenging for countries blessed with energy riches, who are seeking to escape the resource curse and building the bridge from petroleum to prosperity. I know this issue is hotly discussed in the Middle East, but let me assure you, it is an issue that resonates around the globe. It is, in fact, an existential challenge for Asia's youngest country and young democracy, Timor-Leste. Timor-Leste is a small alpha island nation that sits between two regional giants. We are situated within the world's largest archipelago, Indonesia, with its wealth of natural resources and over a quarter of a billion people, including being the world's largest Muslim population. Indonesia is fast becoming one of the world's great economies. And to our south, we have Australia, with its mature and modern economy. While Australia was built on the back of its natural resources, it has already successfully diversified with a large and highly skilled service sector. And so, while Timor-Leste is fortunate to be located in East Asia, in the crossroad of Indic and Pacific, one of the most dynamic regions on the planet, we must learn how to make the most of this opportunity and create a strong economic foundation for our future. The Timorese people have had a difficult past. They endured 500 years of Portuguese colonization, followed by 24 years of brutal foreign occupation. After a long and bloody resistance, Timor-Leste regained its independence in 2002. But the independence came at a high price. Like most post-conflict countries, our early years of independence were difficult. It took time to pick ourselves up and focus on creating peace and building an effective state. But we are resilient, and we slowly began to establish an open economy and a vibrant democracy. Timor-Leste is now considered a leader among fragile, in conflict, post-conflict and developing countries through our leadership of an organization called, I believe you don't know, G7+, a group of 20 countries from the Caribbean to the Middle East, from Africa to the Pacific, who aim to help each other build strong states, fundamental to peace and development. While our people are still poor, Timor-Leste is relatively rich in natural resources, including oil and gas reserves, both in our seas and on our shores. It is this wealth that we must use to develop our country. A priority for the first government of Timor-Leste, following our independence, was to create institutions that would earn our people's trust. One of our best decisions was to establish a sovereign wealth fund. The mandate of our petroleum fund is to manage our energy resources transparently and sustainably for the benefit of all citizens and future generations. Based on Norway's model, every dollar from our petroleum resources goes into the fund, which has grown from its opening balance of 205 million in 2005 to over 16 billion today. This is after already spending more than 10 billion in our annual budgets. Timor-Leste is committed to openness and to the good governance of this fund, and we are proud to be the first nation in the Asia-Pacific region to become compliant with the EITI, Extractive Industries Transparency Initiative. We invest 60% in bonds and 40% in equities, and this has generated, after 5 to 6 years, more than $4 billion in returns. It is these funds that allow us to build our basic infrastructure, schools, hospitals, and to provide, of course, other services to our people. Timor-Leste is now fortunate that we will soon be unlocking the potential of one of our largest and yet untapped gas field known as Great Sunrise. We are able to do this due to an agreement with our neighbor, Australia, through the first ever Conciliation Commission initiated by Timor-Leste under the United Nations Convention of the Law of the Sea. Through the Conciliation Commission, we have been able to reach a landmark agreement on a treaty for maritime boundaries between our two nations and a pathway for the development of Great Sunrise. In a world where maritime boundary disputes are causing rising tensions and global uncertainty, we have proven that the Conciliation Commission provisions of the United Nations can be a vehicle for the peaceful and cooperative resolution of even seemingly intractable disputes. Now, exploitation of the Great Sunrise Field will be able to fuel the economic and social development of our almost next May, our 16 years old country. Ladies and gentlemen, as one of the world's newest nations, we have been able to learn from the successes and failures of others. We are very aware of the pitfalls from over-reliance. With those challenges in mind, in 2010, we started to prepare a 20-year strategic development plan, which was approved by our national parliament in 2011. This plan sets out a vision for a stable democracy with a robust and diversified economy, public services and strong state institutions, and a prosperous society that provides jobs for our people. It covers three key areas: social capital, economic development, and infrastructure development. Investments in social capital aim to build a healthy and educated society, to address the social needs of our people. Investments in economic development will help Timor-Leste achieve a prosperous, modern economy, and most importantly, create jobs. We now have a comprehensive infrastructure plan for building ports, roads, airports, water and sanitation, as well as the transformation of our south coast into a regional petroleum hub. The development of our petroleum hub is called the Tasimane Project. It is in our language. Tasimane means male sea because of its waves on the shores of our south coast. The Tasimane Project will see the development of an open access marine facility and a liquefied natural gas plant. In the session before, we talked too much. We heard too much about gas. What is the future? This is our future also. A pipeline to our shores, an oil refinery and petrochemical industry, an industry supply base, and a 160 kilometers highway linking the three clusters. And finally, the upstream facility and operation, if it is necessary. Together, this project will leverage Timor-Leste's petroleum resources for the long-term benefit of our people. It will provide the foundation for our country to diversify our economy by building other strategic industry sectors, including agriculture, manufacturing, forestry, fisheries, and tourism. And I have to say, tourism is another strategic industry that we have set as a priority. Besides the tropical beauty of its mountains, Timor-Leste has great potential for niche tourism markets such as scuba diving. And I hope you are all scuba diving lovers. And we hope also to drive growth in visitor numbers in the future, especially from the Middle East, because I see many, many people from Middle East in Bali, Denpasar. Ladies and gentlemen, Timor-Leste has plans for the development of our country through a diversified and sustainable economy. However, we know that our small island nation does not exist in isolation. With the benefit of learning from other countries and through partnerships within our region and around the world, it is what we are seeking. Timor-Leste has been able to build a sustainable development strategy. I believe we are well placed to avoid the perils of plenty and become a prosperous nation with a bright future. Timor-Leste hopes to be a good reference for other countries. We saw in the previous session one Africa, five nations in Africa, and I went around Africa also to fragile in conflict and post-conflict countries, and I understand them. For other countries with the same conditions and challenges, this is what is in our, what we face, the underdeveloped countries. But to ensure our example is a positive one, we look to your partnership now, at the critical moment of our country. This conference is a great example of how people from different countries can come together. And I believe also from oil companies, not only to share ideas and lessons they have learned, to give us a better understanding of the future of this industry, but also to build partnerships of friendship, cooperation, and solidarity. I thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Your Excellency. Thank you very much. Thank you for giving us our opening speech there. And again, we all know where we're off on our holidays now, of course, to Timor-Leste. It sounds like the perfect place. And to bring those investment funds. Absolutely. So don't come with an empty pocket. Again, come with an open mind and a big purse. I think that's what it is. And enjoy the fruits of Timor-Leste. It sounds absolutely wonderful and tremendous work that you have been doing indeed over the years. So we're absolutely delighted that you're here with us. Let me get our panel up to the stage here, and we're going to start looking at what we're doing when it comes to economic diversification really in the region. First, if I can call up the chairman of Senat, His Excellency Hussein Jassim Al-Nowais, if he can take his seat. We're thrilled to have him here with us. Another man who's been very busy looking at economic diversification in the region, of course. From the Arab Petroleum Investment Corporation, the chief executive officer joins us also, Ahmed Ali Atiga. Thank you so much, Ahmed. Good to see you on stage. From Parsons in Saudi Arabia, we're thrilled to have with us the senior vice president managing director, Ken Murray, joins us. Ken, thank you so much for taking the time. We're going to be very interested to hear some of the tremendous work that's keeping you busy. From the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development, the Managing Director for Economics, Policy and Governments, Mattia Romani. Mattia, join us. And also from the Abu Dhabi Investment Authority, the Global Head of Research, Christoph Rule, joins us. So as you can see, we have a very diverse panel here for us, and I'm really looking forward to actually this discussion. And of course, we're here until 12 o'clock, and I really would like some input from all of you. My name is Etna Trainer, and I'm obviously going to be your moderator here for this session. So please have a listen to what's going on here, but we'll give them a chance to give their views, of course, but then I'll be very, very happy to hear what you have to say. Actually, Christoph, I'd like to start with you, if I may. I know you're almost in another country down there. It's quite a big panel we have. And when we look at economic diversification, what we were looking at, give us an overview in terms of what do you perceive economic diversification? What's your definition?
I like that. When I was sitting here, she was telling me, don't talk long, we want to have a conversation. And then she says, what's your view on it?
So yeah, okay, what's your short view?
I think it's a good question, and I think it's an important one, because of course people talk about diversification all the time and have really very vague notions of what it means. And I think it has at least four aspects of it. I just name them, then we can discuss them and group the region in it. Number one is the most popular one, what most people mean. They want to know how much of the economy is directly dependent on whatever the extra revenue is, in our case from oil and gas, in other cases from copper, or from some current account surplus, or from privatization, whatever the case is. let's stick with oil and gas. And the question is, what's the percentage of revenues for the budget? In this case here, somewhere between 30 and 60%. What's the percentage of exports coming from that particular oil and gas sector here, somewhere between 40 and 60%? And then the real question, the reason why people ask this is they want to know how much of the economy in terms of GDP is produced by this oil and gas revenues and how much is independent from it. And then they come up with these concepts, which is one of them is oil GDP and one of them is non-oil GDP. And I hope we can discuss those later. I'm a bit critical of those. But when you go by these concepts then for the GCC, the result would be that by now about 57% of the GCC economy is classified as non-oil GDP. In my eyes, again, it's a bit of a nonsense notion, but I'm going to bitch about it later and just state the facts right now. In the year 2007, the non-oil GDP crossed the 50% threshold. So that's one, but it's not the only one, of course. I would also think another one is the structure not only of the economy by production and GDP, but also of employment, very important. Because typically, when you have resource-dependent economies, the share of employment in those resource sectors is very small. Right? And so the revenues, the ball of money coming from selling those revenues to governments can be very large. And so what typically happens is that it's government which then starts to initiate investment and employment and all sorts of other things. And that is a really important one because to some extent determines competitiveness and resilience of the economy. Here in the GCC, it's extraordinary. I mean, in terms of employment, when you split between expatriate workers and local workers, you have about 95% of the public sector comprised of local workers, 85% at least of the private sector comprised by expatriate workers. And now guess which of the two is more productive, more competitive. So that is an important thing. It's a centerpiece of the Saudi 2030 reform program to expand the role of the private sector and in particular the role of nationals in the private sector. As everybody knows, and I don't need to belabor the obvious, it's a very tricky and complicated thing to actually change these ratios. But when it comes to long-term resilience, competitiveness of an economy, that's another key variable. And just as a footnote, for Abu Dhabi, the numbers look similar, bad as for Saudi. For the UAE, they're not published, which I think is also speaking not very good.
We'll come back to that, Joe, and we'll examine it in more detail. Okay. If I can leave it there for a moment.
So the two others, just very briefly. One is when you are getting your revenues from oil and gas, generally it's also difficult then to diversify energy consumption away from oil and gas. You have a heavy dominance of that, which is usually subsidized, which then very often leads to a situation like here, where the efficiency with which the energy is used is worse than in importing countries. And the last one is there's also one benefit from being resource dependent, and that is this windfall of money, which is there, allows you to take some funds away for a rainy day in a way other economies cannot, usually then put into sovereign wealth funds. And that's a fourth segment which
and
comes
keep those,
under this
those funds at work at ADIA.
Yeah,
yes? And many other sovereign wealth funds indeed around the region as well. Mattia, if I can talk to you in terms of what the EBRD is doing and when we look particularly at diversification of economy, how absolutely essential this is. This is where you certainly have first-hand knowledge in the work that the EBRD does. But how important is it, again, that everybody really takes this, I'm sure every economy is taking this very, very seriously, and making sure that diversification is there?
Absolutely. All our countries take that very seriously, particularly the ones that are very dependent on energy. Just as a reminder for the people that may not be familiar with the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development, we operate between now Morocco and Mongolia, so we cover all of Central Asia, Estonia to Egypt. So we cover a very large bit of the world. Countries like Azerbaijan, Kazakhstan are working very closely with us. But I want to put the attention on one thing that we are doing, because we heard from Christoph the definition. We all know and are familiar with the curse around natural resources, with the an imperative of diversification. But in our experience at EBRD, what we notice is the traditional recipe for diversification, either invest in infrastructure and education, or pick the winners in other sectors, non-resource related, and push investment in there. Those do not work in our countries of operations unless they have strong institutions. This is something we've seen very strongly in our countries. There's a very good piece, I will point you to one of our old transition reports, 2009, take a look. it's on this topic, but also in this year's transition report, we've done a piece of research which shows how countries that have better institutions, and by this I mean better rule of law, competition authorities, regulatory authorities, which are transparent, that work well, which are responsive to public requests, business ombudsmen, all the institutions that allow the private sector to operate better. Countries that have better institutions are systematically performing better in terms of diversifying their economies, in increasing exports in non-resource-related sector. What does this mean? That if you want to diversify by picking winners, if you want to diversify by investing in infrastructure and education, this will work only if you have in place strong, transparent institutions that will make investments in the sector less risky, that will really fight against the curse of human capital and physical capital concentrated in the resource-rich sectors. So, of course, you can look at countries that have done it very successfully, have your examples, places like Norway, for example. They started having access to very large amounts of money and revenues through natural resources once those institutions were already in place, and they managed to retain a very strong, very diversified economy. But what do you do in countries like Kazakhstan or Azerbaijan, where those institutions are not that strong? Well, what we have learning at EBRD is that starting from building those institutions really works. So in Azerbaijan, in Kazakhstan, the greatest majority of EBRD's investments is around improving the business environment, is around de-risking sectors which are not related to natural resources, so the private investors have incentives to invest there. They are around building skills in non-resource related sectors, so supporting private sector companies to build a strong workforce that can really add value in those sectors. And that works, and that's irreversible. That's what our research shows. Once you invest successfully in those institutions, once you build those skills, once you attract the private sector to the non-resource related sectors, that is irreversible. Even during the booms in natural resources, when typically you would see a big switch to natural resources, there are incentives, there are vested interests to keep these other sectors going. There are people that have been trained, that have the skills to keep these sectors going, and that really works.
Now, Parsons, Saudi Arabia, of course, can very much non-resource investor but again, you're a major construction player right across the region. But in Saudi, you have some very, very exciting projects. And again, these are not just big infrastructures that projects you're working on. These are very much projects that are needed to really move the economy to the next level. Give us a feel for some of those projects. And again, taking what Mattia says, you're obviously comfortable working in this environment and really building cities of the future, so to speak.
Thank you, and thanks for the opportunity to speak. Saudi Arabia is an interesting place. I've been there over a year now and I've been engaged in several of the large projects. I'm the general manager for our company in Kingdom, so I get to visit all of these sites. The transformational projects, what I would classify as transformational projects that I see in Kingdom are infrastructure projects that are changing the mobility of the society and also the ability of the society to engage in the economy. That's a big part of it. Also, the entertainment cities and the diversification around tourism is extremely popular in Kingdom right now. The Edge Entertainment City, which is a large entertainment city specifically designed for the Saudi population. It's about 25 kilometers west of Riyadh, and it is going to have several aspects of entertainment. It's going to have a motorsports park. It's going to have a Six Flags, has already been announced for the facility. And it's in a geographically an amazing location within the kingdom. So that's, and it's interesting because they've spent a lot of time talking about who is going to use this facility. And it's not for international tourism, it's for domestic tourism. Another one that's very interesting and we're heavily engaged in is the Red Sea project. I'm sure people have heard about it. It's on the Red Sea, not surprisingly. There's a series of islands that are in an ecologically unique zone of the country, and the Crown Prince, Mohammed bin Salman, has selected this location to build an international tourism site, and it's going to be a very high-end, very low-impact, from an environmental point of view, type of resort, and it's going to be strictly for international visitors. And it's unique because of its location and because of its geography, but it's also going to be unique because of the Crown Prince's strong desire to have that retained in the development. So he's not looking to bulldoze it and build a bunch of high rises and those sorts of things. So a lot of interesting things going on. The one thing I would say about the diversification is that the leadership in Saudi Arabia has sent a very clear message around what the main drivers are, and it's stakeholder engagement. It is employment of the youth. So we mentioned being able to drive employment. This is about driving Saudi employment into the private sector, and Saudi has a unique demographic. About 65% of its population is under the age of 35. So if you're ever going to be in a position to drive a generational change from attitudes around employment, now is the time, and I think that the Saudi leadership is jumping on that. So,
well, we'll talk more about some of those specific projects, but certainly keeping you very busy there without a doubt, too. But it must be also fascinating, I think, to be in Saudi Arabia at the moment to be part of this, too.
Someone mentioned the change in Abu Dhabi when they come back here and see the construction. The social change underway in Saudi is happening at just the same rate with the transition to a more moderate Islam state and the government's stated objective of doing that. It's a fascinating time. It's an unbelievable time to be engaged in that country.
Now, Ahmed, you're new in this role, which is wonderful, with the Arab Petroleum Investment Corporation, but of course you bring tremendous background in terms of private equity and the World Bank into this role. Talk to us a little bit about what economic diversification means, particularly for the Arab Petroleum Investment Corporation. It's not just alternative investment in alternative energy.
Thank you very much, first of all, for the invitation to be in this conference. And for the first time in my new capacity, and also to be among distinguished colleagues. Just before I answer your question, I want to emphasize that the curse of the resource abundant economies in this region and in emerging markets in particular, the so-called Dutch disease, for those of you who are familiar with this phenomena, has been on for a long time, 40, 50 years. Mm-hmm. And countries of different sizes, of different resource capacity, of different institutional development levels have suffered with this phenomena for a long time. Some have succeeded, others have made progress. Lack of diversification and consumption-based economies, but also importers of oil in this region, the Jordans, the Egypts, the Moroccos, have also made progress and then regressed, including in this region. In this region, it's not only the oil exporting countries that have seen this phenomena of lack of diversification and consumption-based. About time, I think, for this region to embrace the change that would come, that should come with diversification in both their resource sectors and of course non-oil, so to speak, sectors. And this is, I think, what a country like the UAE, possibly Saudi Arabia, will start have started to show signs of seriousness in tackling this what I characterize as a strategic downfall that these countries, of course, not to talk about the Libyas and the Iraqs of this region, that have gone into totally different circumstances when the potential for these very rich economies to grow was there at certain. Of course, this brings us to talking about institutions, lack of which, oppressive regimes, et cetera, et cetera. So I just want to put this general context to the subject that we're discussing. Apicorp is a multilateral investment bank, development bank, owned by the 10 oil Arab producing countries. Was established in 1975, so it's a 43-year-old, it's not new. And the main mandate of Apicorp when it was established was to help the economies of the region and the member countries to grow their petroleum industries. That's where the name comes from. However, of course, over time, the mandate of Apicorp has evolved as well, and now a role that this very solid, financially solid institution can play is to help the economies of the region diversify both away from oil and within oil. So also the vertical diversification of the oil sector in these economies is becoming, and of course the diversification of the energy mix is becoming is becoming a major, I think, objective that a vehicle like an investment vehicle like EPICORP can help with. Another element that we will be focusing on in our strategy going forward is to help regional investors in go outside the region and help economies. This morning we heard about Africa, for example. So I think this is a role that that a vehicle like EPICORP can play. Thanks.
Thank you, and we'll look into that. Now, Your Excellency Al-Nawaz, listening very attentively to the bigger picture there when we look at, but you know your background too, it's in banking, it's investments, it's project, it's very, very diverse too. But the work that you're doing at Sanaat is almost, a tremendous example of economic diversification in terms of what's been happening and the manufacturing that's in place, the growth of the industrial part of this economy too. But firstly, give us a feel for what you think, a sort of an overall look from the Abu Dhabi perspective in terms of the importance of economic diversification for the country very much.
Thanks, Idri. The Abu Dhabi government, actually His Highness Sheikh Mohammed bin Zayed, the Crown Prince, have almost 10 years ago, have launched the Abu Dhabi 2030 vision. That vision is primarily focused on economic diversification. And the objective of that vision was to reduce dependency on oil. His Highness have always said, when we export the last barrel of oil out of Abu Dhabi, we should be happy. And that drives us all into executing a vision where we reduce the dependency on oil. The vision of Abu Dhabi 2030 focused on several sectors as enabling sectors to drive the diversification. Industries, which I could elaborate more on later on, is a major one. Tourism, services, knowledge-based economy. To achieve this diversification, we had to embark on a vision or a plan. The plan was, A, to ensure there is a proper infrastructure to accommodate industrial base. You see that there are industrial zones in Abu Dhabi, in Al Ain, in Dubai, in Sharjah, in Ras Al Khaimah, in Fujairah. Secondly, logistics. You want to ensure that there is enough connectivity, whether it's roads, ports, airports. And UAE is blessed to have more than 7 or 8 ports today and 7 or 8 airports. Railway, our friend Aweda is the chairman of the railway here, who's also trying to connect the industrial zone to the ports. Human capital, training, developing those who would run industries, whether it's vocational training institutes or other training methodologies. The processes itself, to get a license for a factory about 12, 13 years ago in Abu Dhabi would have taken you at least 2 to 3 months. Today it takes you 2 to 3 days. So all of this facilities to help create that industrial base, which is a driving force of diversification. On the other hand, on tourism, if you look at UAE today, I was reading last night the figures on we are approaching almost 20 million tourists. Yes. Between leisure travel and business travel. We have over 130,000 hotel rooms. There are the Louvre Museum, which we are proud to have launched last year, the Guggenheim Museum, which is coming up, the theme park, you talked about Saudi Arabia doing Six Flags. UAE is doing Six Flags. UAE is doing the Warner Brothers Studios, the Ferrari World, the Dubai Parks and Resorts. All these are attraction to attract more tourism, which is another way of diversification of the economy. Financial services. We are sitting here in this island, Maria Island, which is home to the Abu Dhabi global market. Another way of diversification that helps to create a platform in this region for the financial services and the fintech around. Dubai Financial Center is another one. The Abu Dhabi stock market, the Dubai stock market combined have about $200 billion of market cap with over 135 companies listed in the two exchanges. The Abu Dhabi global market here is trying to attract international companies to come and have base in the region. All of this is diversification. Our friends from ADIA talked about the sovereign funds. The three main sovereign funds in the UAE, whether it's ADIA or ADIC or Mubadala, collectively perhaps could be the largest sovereign fund in the world, the three of them together. All of that are means of diversification of our economy.
Super. Well, thank you for giving us that overview, too. And sometimes we forget about it when we get consumed in the energy sector sometimes. And we have to look beyond that and really just looking around us here, particularly in Abu Dhabi. Christoph, if I can come back to you. And when we look at, you know, the sovereign funds and the use and the, I mean, what are you targeting at the moment when you look at it? And what are the considerations that your office really looks at in terms of how to deploy this money and make sure that it is actually, you know, to the best use?
Well, in terms of deploying in money or investing, and so I'm not at liberty to say very much,
except course, that ADIA is driven maybe by... maybe sectors.
As he has said, ADIA is driven by this idea of investing outside the region, investing outside energy, with the purpose of generating enough financial resources so that indeed the day the last barrel of oil is produced, people here walk home with a smile on their face. And what this translates to very simply is when you have a resource below ground such as oil, which is finite either by supply or by demand peaking at some point, the demand will go down. You draw it down in a linear fashion. Your wealth below ground goes down a certain amount every single year. When you take that money and you invest it somewhere, it generates interest. You reinvest the interest and you have exponential growth. So you can actually do a very good job when you don't take the money and you keep it invested somewhere in building up financial wealth, which eventually will be capable of matching or exceeding or being slightly below, who knows, depends how long you do it, how disciplined you do it, the wealth which used to come from oil. That's an extraordinary privilege because other economies don't have that. Now, let me make one other thing. I liked all these different measures here. Very often discussions about resource curse, they get this air of it's inevitable, no one knows anything about how to do about it. And so, and it's true what Mani has said, that you can observe around the world that in countries which have developed institutions, rule of law and all that, diversification seems to be much less of a problem than in countries which are more sort of, say, we say economic development, earlier stages of it. So Canada, Australia, Norway seem to be having not much of a problem with it. Nigeria, Venezuela, the Middle East seems to have a bigger problem with it. But that's not very helpful. So I would even go further. I would say when countries find natural resources and they already have developed institutions, they can deal with it much better than if they find with it when they're in an early stage of development. But again, that's not helpful because it implies sort of there's little you can do. But what we see here is that you can actually do a lot about it. And I think the best example is when we look at energy. When you have, like the Middle Eastern economies, places which are dependent on energy resources, then the temptation usually is to use these, in this case oil and gas, to produce all your domestic energy needs. The first consequence is that when you measure it in real prices, it's more expensive than anywhere else. Power generation costs here are more expensive than elsewhere because the real cost of this oil and gas is more expensive than coal and nuclear and renewables these days. The second temptation is you have enough money, so you subsidize it. The results of that reveal a hidden cost, which can be actually quite dramatic, and that hidden cost is the efficiency with which the subsidized energy is used. And that's an example I wanted to bring here. When you look globally, the efficiency with which oil is used in producing something has improved dramatically over the last 40, 50 years, more than 2% every year. The easy way to measure it is you measure how much oil do I need to produce $1,000 of GDP, say. The answer is, in the late 70s, it peaked at about one barrel, so it's almost 160 liters of oil for $1,000 of GDP. It's a lot. By now, globally, has fallen by a half. So we're using about 75, 80 liters of oil globally to produce $1,000 of GDP. Right? It's gone down everywhere, with one exception globally, and this is this region, where energy intensity has increased, efficiency has actually declined until the last few years. And the level is interesting, it's very different. So as I told you, globally, maybe 75 liters per $1,000. In the UAE, about twice as much. In the GCC, about three times as much, and Saudi Arabia about 4 times as much. That shows you not just a disaster scenario, it also shows you that these things can be changed. Because what you have in the UAE is a much more competitive price system, which is now being developed, and an immediate impact on the efficiency which energy is used. And what you have in other countries is much less of that. And in Saudi Arabia, traditionally, you have the biggest subsidies and the least efficiency gains. So to some extent, it's not only institutions and things which are very difficult and complicated to fix. It. He's exactly right. To some extent, it is projects in certain sectors, the right incentives, the right price structure. And you see an impact. That impact is sort of hardwiring, whether resource dependency translates into resource curse or whether it translates into something which has more prospects for the future.
And definitely, I think that's what they're driving at very much here in the region. Mattia, talk to us where you see the role of the sovereign wealth funds and, you know, particularly in the wider regions as well.
Yeah, thank you. So first, I want to make 3 points. The first is an observation about the fact that it's very sad to always call it a resource curse. I mean, ultimately, having natural resources is a blessing, and it offers phenomenal opportunities. So let's start with that. It's a good thing. Yes.
Should be a good thing. And not everybody has this. It's
exactly.
Not created equally.
You want to make
yes.
the best of it. So the second observation is that natural resources, per se, on their own, they're not going to be able to sustain an economy. And that's obvious. So if you take even, you know, a country which is as blessed as this one with natural resources, I'm not sure how big the sovereign wealth fund is, probably 300-400% of the GDP, something like this. Even if you have a sovereign wealth fund of that dimension, so 4 times as big as the total GDP of the country, right? And you think about a 3% return on that, that is going to build 10% a year of GDP. That's not
a small enough, big enough economy with large enough natural resources. Of course, they can sustain it forever. Why not?
Well, no. In my view, they can't, because the sizes are just not there. Take that number I gave you. Sovereign wealth fund, how big is it? 400% of GDP currently? 500%?
Natural resources below the ground.
No, fair enough. I'm talking about sovereign wealth fund. So 400% of GDP, 3% return, 12% of GDP. That's not big enough, right? You've got to make that money build other bits of the economy, or you have to make those natural resources return more. Another way of looking at this, take the per capita allotment. So if you take the U.S., if the U.S., I mean, it's surprising. If you take the pure value of the natural resources in the U.S., they're about $2,000, $2,500 per capita a year. That's the value of the natural resources in the U.S. The same is true for countries like Iran or Algeria, which sometimes you think are. So per se, the natural resources have a role to play, but they have a role in order, you have to use them in a way that allows you to build a big economy. And that's really, to me, the absolutely crucial point. And the third observation is that I completely agree with Christoph, it's not enough to say, if you don't have the institutions, then, well, tough luck, you won't be able to diversify. Of course, that's not the message. The message is that as you diversify the economy, you have to do it hand in hand with building those institutions. Yes, yes. And again, we are in a country that did it very, very well. And you can see it in the results. Building institutions as you diversify your economy allows it to be sustainable. That's why I would say practically 2 or 3 things that you can do, and that incidentally the UAE has done very, very well in this, in my view, are the following. First, financial institutions. To diversify the economy, you need risk capital.
Can you bring us through the list just quickly on those? Because we've only got about 15 minutes, and we have Sebastian and Emily is somewhere here. I do know if you can just position yourselves, and perhaps if some people want to get some questions in.
Okay.
But sorry, Mattia, if you can just quickly bring us through the list, because also I want to get Ahmed to come back in here on the fact that, you know, while we need to look at that economic diversification, we need to be keeping our eye on the ball on energy at the moment as well.
Okay, so I'll give you the list of the ingredients, and please accept that it's not a perfect recipe, it's just ingredients. First, risk capital. Use the money you have in sovereign wealth funds and elsewhere for risk capital for non-resource sector. Equity, small stakes, minority shareholder equity. Second, use the value chains around the energy sector to start diversifying. It's the easiest way in. Start with the value chain for the natural resource sector and try to make the activities in those value chains useful for other sectors as well. So you start building incentives for them to survive. And third, and we talked about it, skills. build your skills from the bottom up. First skills for the private sector, what you need to make the non-resource sectors work, and then eventually go, like UAE has done very successfully, into higher education and the highest level of training.
Super. Mr. Alvarez, you want to come in on this first, so I'll bring you in on this particular issue.
You mentioned very important points, our friend mentioned, the value chain, for example. Let me tell you what we are doing here in industries. The value chain, we have created a cluster of industries. Yes. When we started our economic diversification with industry as a base, we first looked at what are the advantages we have in this country. Obviously, energy, despite the fact that we are trying to diversify away from it, is still a cornerstone of our plan. So we looked at industries which produce basic material, aluminum. Today, we have been able to succeed to have the fifth largest aluminum producer in the world, in this country. And aluminum produce material for so many downstream industries to create an aluminum cluster industries. And we have done so in Khalifa Industrial Park. We're proud to have that today. So many industries using aluminum as material. Secondly, Abu Dhabi National Oil Company, through its subsidiary, Buruj, have produced petrochemical complex around 5 million ton a year today. Buruj is a major player. That produce material to produce a cluster of downstream industries, being plastic, be it others, components. We have in Al Ain Strata producing components for aircraft using material out of this. Thirdly, steel and Sana'at, we have created Emirates Steel, which again produce material for downstream industries. So the value chain coming out of the oil and gas through these three basic industries have helped us to create a cluster of industries, be it in Al Ain or Abu Dhabi or Dubai or the other Emirates.
I see you want to come in on this when we're looking, Ken, but also looking at the cluster of industries perhaps that you're involved with too in Saudi Arabia. Do you see that they're maybe looking around the world, looking at best practice and actually beginning to develop similar type projects?
They actually are. You talked about deindustrialization around the oil industry. They do the same thing, energy industrial cities, they call them. Steel manufacturer, pipe manufacturer, wire, transformers, all of the building blocks to construct and implement facilities for oil and gas support. There's a huge drive to have that developed in country as well. And the one thing I would say is that a lot of the conversation in Saudi Arabia is about lessons learned and best practices from this part of the region. So there's they're not trying to reinvent the wheel. They are really
looking
around.
And one of your big projects too, of course, is the metro.
The Riyadh Metro is a huge...
The connectivity.
What that's doing is, anybody who's visited Riyadh in the last couple of years would know this, it is a transformational project within the city. They are trying to connect the city for a number of reasons, not the least of which is to drive the economic engine. They're trying to make it more of a financial center. They have a partially constructed financial district, which they're going to resurrect and finish, and the connectivity to that, to the airport, and to the industrial areas in the city is what they're driving at for the Riyadh Metro. Again, a lesson learned from other cities and other large centers.
Christoph, you want to come in here on the... I will come back to you, Ahmed. I've given you warning for a question ages ago. We are going to come back. At least you'll have plenty of time to think about it.
Having praised the efforts, I now have to put in a word of warning, because it's not good enough to say we have building up a value chain if that is either based on subsidies or completely on foreign labor, which takes either the remittances or the profits, takes them immediately out of the country. And when we look seriously at one of the very few measures we have on seeing how successful diversification has been in the GCC, then I have to come back to this notion of non-oil and oil GDP. And while it looks as if the share of the non-oil GDP, which would include these aluminium factories and all of this, is steadily rising, it's true, there is a puzzling sign here, which is when you take the growth of non-oil GDP for the GCC year after year after year, and you overlay it with the oil price, very simple, you get a relationship of 1-to-1. Every single year the oil price goes up, the growth of the non-oil sector increases. Every single year the oil price goes down, growth of the non-oil sector decreases. That's a sure sign that there still is a long way to go. I don't want to trash anybody's efforts, but we have to realize that there's a reason for us discussing diversification 50 years after oil was discovered. it is very, very, very difficult to actually unwind economies from that, and it takes a very long time. So a lot of efforts have been made, but overall, by that measure, I don't think we are there yet.
But again, I mean, this process, I think, has only started not too long ago, to give credit, I think, to the government and to everybody.
It has started here faster than anywhere else in the region, that's true.
It started 10 years ago.
Yeah, so it takes time.
And it takes time, but also other sectors are playing a role. I mean, last year, tourism alone brought $40 billion of spending in UAE, $40 billion. It's coming almost...
Christoph is working so hard, he doesn't have time to look at that sector.
Almost at 10%.
We don't have time to get out and see the fun that's going on.
It's about 10% of GDP. Industry is about 15% of GDP. 10 years ago when we started the Abu Dhabi Vision 2030, oil was above 50%. Today, it's below. We are talking about the UAE. Today is almost 35% of oil present. So it is working.
But as well as that, and the need for it, I think, and we hear the argument and agree with the argument, but we also have to sort of keep our eye on the ball, so to speak, and make sure there's still lots of investment in the energy sector. And for the moment, too, in the petroleum sector. I mean, we can't, it's not all going. Ahmed's been waiting on this one a while.
No, sure. I think colleagues have already alluded to some aspects of diversification within the resource abundant sector. I think the vertical diversification along the value chain will bring this potential to the sector. The local content aspect of linkages that will have a spillover effect, employment effect, are all examples of how diversification, let alone, of course, the overarching diversification of the energy mix itself. But since I have the microphone, I just want to allude to two aspects. One is the role of SME development, small and medium enterprises development. I think Mr. Romani mentioned the conducive framework, regulatory, legal, institutional, that have to be in place. I'm sure most of you are familiar with the doing business indicators that the IFC and the World Bank publishes every year. These indicators are, for example, what UAE has excelled in, what Saudi Arabia has started to excel in, and the results of excelling in these indicators is really what makes diversification much, much easier, given that these are the tools to diversify. The last point I want to make is that governments in the region, particularly the oil-producing governments, are being pressured, of course, because of the very tight fiscal space, to also diversify the sources of financing. So we're seeing public-private partnership schemes. We're seeing the role of the private sector in financing mega projects much, much more successful than before. And I think all of these are powerful tools for diversification and keeping the pressure on governments to continue in that path.
Mr. Al-Nawais, we do have time for maybe one question. If anybody has that, please go ahead.
Elaborate more on what Ahmed just said on SME and what Matteo said about risk capital and skill building. We have, through changing hats for me, Khalifa Fund, which is an organization supported by the Abu Dhabi government to help SME. We have, over the last 10 years, have created a very strong base of SME where we provide risk capital at zero interest. We also build skills through training. That is a major way of building that sector, which Ahmed alluded to. And on the risk capital element, there are many other institutions helping to create that industries. Emirates Industrial Bank, or now it's called Emirates Development Bank, is one which provide risk capital to those who are interested to build businesses, startup businesses, above the small and medium. So you have the small and medium through Khalifa Fund, you have a larger one through Emirates Development Bank. All of these are building skills and providing capital to the young nationals who are ambitious to build a strong. We are, you know, one more aspect, the role of the private sector, which we have, again, part of the diversification, part of the Abu Dhabi 2030 vision, took a major step. We have in Sana'at started to privatize some of the government-owned industries, so the private sector taking a stake of that. We have been listing some of these industries in the Abu Dhabi Stock Exchange. We're encouraging the private sector to complement what is missing. We encourage the supplier of the private sector to provide us with the material and the resources we need in this industry.
Now I'm getting, we have maybe one question and then I am going to take time just to wrap it up. We give to Ibrahim here. But if you can also be thinking, each one of you, just a closing word in terms of what needs to be done maybe very, very quickly to actually move economic diversification, what you'd like to see, or maybe a new idea that hasn't come across yet. Ibrahim.
Ibrahim Fahmy, offshore consultant. I totally agree with our friend when he talked about the linkage between the oil price and GDP. Actually, we need to build a trust on diversification. Until today, the investment is very afraid of the low oil price, sine wave, which affected the market severely. And until today, the government need to work to build a trust. Regardless the oil price is or will be, there is no affecting on the business and the private sector. This trust will be built coming from top to down. But actually, what we can see is the government saying that it will come from down to up. This is
the other way. Okay, well, thank you for that comment. Christoph, so we just wrap this up, this discussion here. And when we look at the need, as you said, it's moving slowly, but I think you must give some credit that it's moving. What do you think would actually perhaps speed that up and maybe add to the economic diversification and really make it work better? And again, just in closing comments on this, so we have to wrap it up quickly.
Yeah, so I've always been short.
You've always been, yeah. It's going, give me the future of the world, but do it in 2 minutes.
Completely against my habits. Okay, so three things. Okay. Number one, I think in the situation here, it doesn't hurt if the government has a clear strategy. It's not necessarily picking winners always bad, but it's clear here. Tourism will work, logistics will work, health things will work. But you know, it's not that when the government creates a lot of companies that solves the problems by itself. Yes. Diversification has been accomplished once you have a global financial crisis, and Dubai, by far the most diversified economy here, can stay on its own feet. Then you have diversification, not before. The single most important thing, I think, is not to do with long-term deliberate government policy. I think at the moment, the single most important thing for generally the prospects in the region and diversification is whether the reforms in Saudi Arabia will actually be successful or not. And this is a really, really, really difficult thing to accomplish, as we will find out.
Yes, and I think the regional impact that will have. Mattia, in terms of, you know, the work that you're doing, and then you look around the region to what could the region do to actually speed this up? Or is it about speeding it up, or is it just about staying the course?
Two observations, and again, I'm thinking about more of our countries of operations, yes, particularly Central Asia. Unfortunately, one of the things that really sped things up in our region of operation is the financial crisis, because countries found themselves in a very difficult position with natural resource prices falling. So we saw real push on this in Azerbaijan and Kazakhstan on the back of the financial crisis. So I'm not advocating for another financial crisis to speed things up, but just observing that that's the case. And then a second observation, I would say, just to rebuild on what I was saying earlier, in my view and from our experience, resource curse is the wrong word. It's really an institution curse. So what I would say we will watch like hawks in our countries, yes, of operations is the possibility that institutions are captured by vested interest in moments of booms of natural resources. We see it happening all over our region of operation. That is the real curse we need to work against, so that we can have strong, transparent, bottom-up institutions that can support the process.
And once those institutions are there, too, it also gives the investor a lot of confidence, and really, you know, it all falls into place. Ken, you know, obviously you're going to continue with some of the great work you're doing in Saudi Arabia, and as Christoph said, everybody watching what's going on there, so For you, in terms of that economic diversification and the role that you're doing, to where do you see the future for it?
I think two things are going to be critical in the world I live in. I think these may be general statements. One of them is a stakeholder involvement and engagement. And when I talk about stakeholders, it's not only the society, but really the investors, because the investors will drive the engine. The second thing that really needs to be focused on, and this is on my wish list, is having the right people doing the work, having the global experts engaged in these developments, both from a technical point of view, from a banking and finance point of view. That's important. I think that the people in charge and the governments need to understand that there's no need to reinvent the wheel. Go get the expertise, bring it in, leverage what those people have to offer, that will be one of the biggest accelerators rather than learn it yourself.
Super. Ahmed, a few words from you, just.
No, I think most of what needs to be said has been said, but I think if I would summarize it, I think the countries of the region are going through, first of all, unprecedented turmoil, yes. And at the same time, unprecedented also potential. I think political will, vision, transparency, good governance, institutional building is what's going to make the difference between those who succeed and those who will continue to fail. I think many countries are in this region are in conflict or soon will be post-conflict. Transformation post-conflict is going to be key to learn the lessons and hopefully not to make the same mistakes. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to leave you with our closing word on this session to Mr. Al-Nouis.
Thank you. I think as far as the Emirates is concerned, where I'm proud to be one of those who are been working hard to make this country stand the way it is, we are at the end of the day, despite the challenges we have, despite whatever been said, we are a country which have remarkably achieved by all milestones. Yeah. 50 years ago, our GDP was less than $1 billion. Today we are $420 billion GDP. These are facts. We have a small country, but we have positioned ourselves as a global player in many different sectors, in many different areas, in many different industries. We have great institutions who have collectively around $1 trillion worth of funds and you know, owned by the country. So we have logistics and infrastructure which have world class. Our airports have over 80 million passengers last year. So, our ports have over 20 million containers last year. These are facts, demonstrates how great this country is, and all of that because we have a leadership of a clear vision, a clear determination to put the UAE in the right place in this global world.
Super. Well, thank you. On that very optimistic note and waving the flag, of course, for the UAE. Yes? You want to join us? Okay. All right. Well, we'll just invite you to it. But just before we close up, sorry on that. Again, as I think we can see from this panel very much, that really, you know, the economic diversification that we've seen, it's certainly a journey. It's not, and I think it's going to be continue to be a journey, and it's probably something that's going to be happening for years. I don't think one arrives at an economy that is, you know, maybe suitably economically diversified. I think when we look around the world, everybody wants to do something a little bit different. But I do want to thank you all for your tremendous input and using all of your great experience to actually share with us your views on this and enlighten us a little more in terms of what to do. But the challenges that are out there, but without a doubt, plenty of opportunities, I think, as well. So just to my dear audience here, a big thanks. And then we'll sit and let's just wait for a moment. And thank you.
Thank you, Etna. I'm Ellen Scholl. I work with the Atlantic Council's Global Energy Center, and I truly just wanted to thank our moderator for really driving and facilitating a fascinating conversation. And to all of you on the panel for really providing such a valuable kind of diversity of insights, lessons learned, best practices, lists of ingredients even, and actually some tips on top travel destinations. So truly a wide-ranging conversation. And we very much thank you, Your Excellency, for your framing remarks and your insights into where Timor-Leste is going and the measures that they've been taking. So I now have the very unenviable position of being between you and the lunch. So I just wanted to give you a couple of key housekeeping items. We invite you to a lunch outside on the Liwa Terrace. You can get there by exiting the room through the reception area. It will go until 1 p.m. And we hope you will all join us upstairs in Elmira Ballroom at 1 p.m. for a fireside chat on Nigeria and the 7 big wins to continue this conversation with the Nigerian Minister of State for Petroleum Resources, facilitated by the fantastic John Depterios of CNN. So thank you all for your attention. Thanks for being here and for being part of a conversation that we really are excited to have in the UAE, such an innovator when it comes to forward-thinking economic strategy and diversification. So we appreciate your comments and your commentary, and we look forward to continuing the conversation next year. Please enjoy the lunch. Thank you.
Thank you, Ellen. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks again, my dear. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Hansi. Well done.